Secret of the Dormant Brain Lab, The Adventures of Niles Abercrombie and the Book of Wands, Volume 1, by Neil Slade. Read by the author. Chapter 7, Mass Insanity. Most people would have given up and never returned after that first baptism by fire. Not me. I kept coming back to the lab. I wanted microscopic vision. I wanted ESP. I wanted genius creativity, just like all those people I saw in the movie that late night on TV. I wanted to pop my frontal lobes, whatever that was. Before long, I learned that Stingo's bark was far worse than his bite. The guard dog growl that many people found themselves on the ear receiving end of was just the first thing that separated the men from the boys, the women from the girls. Stingo's sting was his method of testing for the lie of desiring 100% brain. Too many just wanted to be entertained for a little bit. Too many wanted a temporary diversion. Stingo had to filter out all these kinds of people, or he would have ended up wasting his whole life on curiosity seekers. But even if he managed to stick around after the first shock treatment wore off, Stingo was a tough teacher. He would at times appear to be arrogant, unyielding, argumentative, and even crude and corrosive. Then, at the drop of an aspen leaf, he'd transform into the most compassionate, kind, gentle, and caring person you might ever meet. Stingo often expressed an unusual adult playfulness combined with an unconventional sense of humor that one might expect of a child. His wisdom and experience was housed within a person that might appear as a bellowing, sign-waving doomsdayer 1 minute, and then he would be off innocently playing kitty hide-and-seek with your brain the next. To the casual observer, it might seem as though he was schizophrenic, a loony bird. But underneath it all, if one looked beyond the surface, one would sense a great depth and wisdom. Ultimately, for the dedicated student, it was the city and all of its inhabitants that seemed insane by comparison. Stingo lived a relatively simple and carefree existence without all of the trappings of modern life. He lived modestly on an old bootstring budget for necessities and not much more. He was in touch with the core meaning of life that escaped most urban dwellers found endlessly running on the spinning treadwheel of consumerism and materialism. Up at the brain lab, it was you, your brain, and nature. Not much more was required to feel content. Time with Stingo at the lab, especially if one enrolled for the intensive 6-week brain and nature course, consisted of an eclectic study of brain physiology and anatomy, behavior science, and psychology. Add to this a dose of mysticism, yoga, and non-denominational meditation. Mix all that with personal counseling and a measure of plain old sweat-inducing physical labor. Top it off with starlit sing-alongs round the campfire, and you have your dormant brain lab experience. I spent the next 4 years hanging out at the brain lab, visiting every week or so when the weather was nice, and writing long letters to Stingo in the winter when there was too much snow to drive up the narrow dirt road in my Datsun. Let it be known, I rarely followed the same standard course of brain self-control prescribed for his regular and paying students, far from it. But I was intensely interested and curious, and I was hard to scare off. I began to help Stingo with lab chores and assisted organizing and promoting lectures and classes down in Denver. Thus, he tolerated me hanging around and put up with my questions, my stubborn skepticism, independence, and reluctance to follow his prescribed methods to the letter. I expect that he recognized his own rebelliousness in me, and so we got along well enough. As the years went by, I saw fewer and fewer people at the brain lab. But then, come to think of it, I hardly saw anybody up there to begin with. The 70s might have been the decade of self-discovery, and that's when the lab flourished. But the decade that followed was that of the me, me, me generation. Even though I tried to help Stingo recruit new students, by the time I arrived on the scene starting in 1982, far fewer people were interested in brain self-control beyond a quick sampling, beyond dunking one's toe into the cerebral spinal fluid of knowledge. It seemed like the cultural environment of the 1980s had people focusing on fattening their bank accounts and skimping on their brains. My circle of friends was a bit different, however, and I managed to occasionally recruit my musician and artist buddies to help out for an afternoon. We would gather firewood and drag it down the mountain in exchange for more than a few words of neurological wit and wisdom from the brain man himself. In time, I was absolutely confident that I was on the right track, even though my big brain bang, that internal frontal lobes explosion, seemed forever elusive. I had learned to use all kinds of things at the lab that I'd never expected to master at first. Of course, all from their expected and conventional perspective and use. Axes, saws, hammers, but perhaps more importantly, pens and typewriters. I also began to look at my guitar a lot differently. After all, Stingo had bought and built the whole lab starting with just 3 chords and 9 folk songs on his musical axe. Stingo insisted all of these tools were keys that would open up new dimensions for me as well. Eventually. But first, I had to master that amygdala lever, the master click switch in my brain. Despite my enthusiasm, only one of my best friends took Stingo nearly as seriously as I did. This was a friend of several years, an attractive yoga teacher named Glenda Healthbar. She was a classic and lithe beauty, of pleasant and unassuming good nature, and she shared the same birthday as myself. I had met her at the Yoga and Fitness Center in Denver, a place where I had learned and eventually began to teach a few classes myself. She was exactly 1 year older than me, but unlike me, she had married early in life and already had a couple of small boys to look after. This alone caused her consternation, as both her kids and her husband presented her with unending alarms and challenges, including those concerning her own existence. Thus, she was presented with major impetus to discover how her own brain was put together and revealed what the ultimate purpose of her life was. Glenda had not bought into the phony for-profit promises of happiness advertised on magazine covers and in TV commercials. She knew meaning was not to be bought in a jar of face cream, a new car, or in a vacation cruise. Stingo and the Brain Lab offered something unique beyond convention that might bring her some order to the inner chaos of her world. She thought he might be able to answer the questions that no one else could, or at least provide some clues so that she could solve these riddles for herself. One evening, after an exceedingly hard all-day workout dragging firewood down the mountain trail, Glenda, Stingo, and I sat around a small fire, collecting our thoughts and resting our bones. The moon began to rise in the darkening sky behind us to the east. Glenda poked at the crackling flames with a long stick and asked with her distinctly animated and melodious voice, "Stingo, don't you get lonely up here all by yourself most of the time?" Stingo laughed. "Heck no! I get lonely when I go to the city!" Glenda looked at me and remarked, that doesn't make any sense." "Think about it," Stingo replied. "Analyze it with your frontals. What is loneliness?" Glenda and I looked at each other. I had never seriously contemplated that question before, and I don't think she had either. "It's when you're all by yourself, when you're not connected to anything or anybody," she answered. Stingo smiled broadly and held out his arms widely as if to embrace the forest. At first he said nothing so we could contemplate the answer for ourselves. Then he offered, "What do you feel up here on the mountain? What do you feel right now? Glenda looked around, then closed her eyes and took in a clear, deep breath. The stick in her hands dropped to lightly touch the ground. I feel like I'm part of this. I feel like my mind is just another slice of the woods. I feel like you guys are my friends. Stingo nodded in agreement.
Well, when I'm in the city, I feel like an alien on a strange planet. I can't wait to get home.
Glenda opened her eyes.
Oh, so that's why Niles reminds me of a Martian, she laughed.
I threw a pine cone at her. Stingo reached over and grabbed a small stick and a rock lying beside him. He held the rock in his right hand and the stick in his left. He began to beat the rock with the stick.
This rock is the human brain. Your brain. Every day society tries to grind you down, beat you into meaningless dust. Society doesn't know what else to do with this stick except to use it as a weapon. To destroy.
Stingo shook his head.
Foolish, he said. When you're young, like you are today, you have the strength to resist, he stated as he hit the rock away with the stick. Use your brain to the fullest. Instead of beating on rocks, you can do other things, creative things.
He tossed the stick in my direction. Stingo then began to draw a beautiful design in the dirt with his finger, illuminated by the fire. We looked over and saw that he was making one of those yin-yang symbols surrounded by sun flames. The design flickered with what almost seemed to be a holographic rainbow of colors.
People make the mistake that they think they're going to live forever, but no one does.
Stingo took a deep breath, then looked us directly in the eye. First Glenda, then a slow, lingering stare at me.
My dear friends, today is your time. Take charge of it, because if you're only here to be entertained, then you're not only wasting my time, but your time on that precious and fleeting sundial of life.
I looked at the crooked stick that Stingo had tossed and had landed near my feet. I picked it up, half examining it and half thinking about what he had just said. Maybe it was the light of the fire. Maybe it was my head, light from exhaustion. But I had a hard time bringing the twig into focus. My eyes watered, and the surface of it seemed to flicker with color like a soap bubble. My mind began to wander. Everything else around me began to look fuzzy. Stingo and Glenda continued to talk, but they faded away into the background, receding from my awareness and into a twilight dream. I suddenly found myself inexplicably in what appeared to be a dark space. I was sitting on wooden planks in the middle of an unlit room. Just a faint ray of sunshine made its way through a small crack in the ceiling. There were sparkling spots of light, like dim jewels around me, like colored headlights and taillights in the distance. Suddenly and instantly, everything intensified. I felt and saw sharp bursts of light inside my head, like a light show at a Las Vegas showroom. My mind began to race, the light wanting to burst right out of my head. I felt a formless and frightening pain. I wasn't sure where I was, here, there, wherever I was. I lifted my hands to the side of my head.
Niles! Stingo exclaimed.
Then, like a bubble bursting, it was all gone. I snapped out of the trance. I felt Glenda's hand on my shoulder. I dropped the stick.
You okay?
Glenda asked, her face in front of mine. Stingo got up and kicked the stick into the bushes with the side of his boot.
He's okay,
Stingo assured her as he sits down and casually tends the fire with a metal fireplace poker that was stuck into the ground next to him. I blinked, a little shaken up.
Guess I was exhausted. Worked harder than I thought.
Huh, I said. Okay now?
Stingo asked me, appearing not overly concerned. I wasn't sure what happened,
but I looked down on my body, and it still appeared to be in one piece. I didn't completely expect it to be. Yeah, I guess so, I replied.
Traveling can be tough if you're not ready for it, Stingo replied, poking the fire. You can get burned.
Stingo looked up at Glenda and myself. He appeared to contemplate revealing something he was keeping to himself. We awaited an explanation.
The main thing is, you've got to master your master gear lever first. Your amygdala, he said.
He held up the poker.
That's the main thing. Otherwise, you end up in places you shouldn't go. It's enough. That's enough for me. Others, I don't know.
He looked doubtful. Glenda and I looked at each other. Neither one of us knew exactly what was going on. The air seemed like it had been shot through with electricity for a moment, and I was trying to regain my senses. Stingo looked up at the sky, the stars beginning to emerge. It seemed to have gotten quite dark all of a sudden. His eyes swept across the tops of the trees and the dark forest around us. He spoke quietly but intensely.
People don't even know what's in front of their own noses. They don't even see outside the box. I don't know. It's a big universe out there. It's dangerous. You've got to get your own house in order first before you go wandering across the cosmos. It's too easy to get lost.
We sat there wordless for a few more minutes. I was having trouble following him. Finally, Glenda broke in, her own chirping voice interrupting the chorus of unseen crickets.
So, Stingo, I've never heard anybody else talk like this, the way you do about the brain. Tell me again how you got started and interested in all this brain stuff.
Stingo replied with a wry smile, thinking for a moment.
Okay, come with me.
He got up and waved for us to follow.
Uh-oh, I whispered to Glenda.
We stood up and watched as he grabbed a flashlight hanging on a hook on the outside of his cabin. He began to walk up behind his cabin.
Well, are you coming?
He commanded, without looking back. He continued to walk up the hill up to another bigger and longer cabin that sat about 20 yards uphill, the library. Glenda and I followed, nothing but the sound of three pairs of legs crunching leaves and pebbles under feet as we followed the dim shadow of Stingo behind a wavering flashlight beacon. Outside the library cabin hung a handmade sign with Cyrillic writing written upon it. Stingo pushed the creaking wooden door open into a dark interior, its contents sporadically lit by the dirty dust beam of the flashlight. We all made our way inside. We saw Stingo shuffle over to a long workbench where he found a kerosene lamp and matches. He set down the flashlight and lit the lantern. He turned up and adjusted the flame so that the cabin became more illuminated, yet still leaving unlit deep shadows in the corners of the place. I took a good look around. The place vaguely reminded me of a messy thrift store, a schlock store my mother called that kind of place when I was little. It was stuffed to the gills with tall file cabinets and large boxes stacked 3 and 4 high. There was barely room to navigate the crammed contents. The long wooden workbench and the wall above it had hand tools of all sorts scattered about. Lingo turned around and squeezed between a row of boxes a few feet away and began to methodically look through a few of them, obviously looking for something specific. There was a lot of dust and dirt. Glenda coughed and covered her mouth.
Ah, here it is, Stingo noted, finding a particular large cardboard box.
He picked up the box by the cutout handles and lifted it up onto the workbench, then turned it end around end so that we could see what had been labeled on its side in big letters. It said,
Mass Insanity.
Glenda looked at me and then at Stingo.
This must have stuff about Niles in it. I snickered.
No, no, Stingo replied. This is what you get when enough people click their amygdala backwards. When you get whole continents of human beings clicking backwards into their reptile brain.
Glenda and I were puzzled.
War, Stingo explained. Mass insanity.
Stingo jiggled the lid of the box free and produced a small plume of dirt and dust that made a small cloud momentarily float in the atmosphere of the kerosene lamp.
Some of my souvenirs from the war, he stated as a matter of fact.
He first pulled out a large, ominous-looking knife in a leather sheath. I guess he had this thing about knives. He unsnapped the sheath and slowly drew out the weapon, holding it up for us to see the ornate decorations on the handle. The blade was thick and serrated and flickered in the reflected light of the lantern. In the center of the handle rested an insignia of a skull and crossbones. Glenda grabbed her throat in fright.
Oh my gosh, she gasped.
Perhaps it was only a flush of blood through my eyeballs, but I could have sworn I saw the blade flash red for a moment. Stingo examined the knife himself first, as if to ponder long uncovered memories.
Any tool can be used clicked forward or clicked backward. A blade can be used to heal or...
He paused.
It can be used to kill, I finished his sentence. I had learned that lesson. Precisely.
Stingo handed the knife to Glenda, who reluctantly took it.
My husband has one of these, she said with a drop in her voice.
Stingo raised his eyebrows in surprise. Glenda continued, seeing his reaction.
Oh, not one of these. I mean, he's got some knives, but nothing like this.
Stingo went back to digging around in the box, the exact contents just out of our line of sight. Glenda continued to examine the knife in her hands and seemed to show some discomfort and concern. Stingo then pulled out some war medals and handed them to me.
This is how you coax boys who haven't even started shaving to walk straight into the arms of death. You promise them a medal.
I glanced over at Glenda. Normally, she kept her emotions well at bay, but now she was beginning to show real anxiety on her face. I heard her muttering to herself,
What I'm seeing, this is awful. Oh my gosh.
What was she seeing inside her brain? I thought to myself, staring at her with some concern.
Stingo was suddenly aware of Glenda and the anguish on her face. Here, you better give me that,
he said as he quickly but gently took the knife back from her, tucking it back into the box. There was an awkward, uncomfortable silence. Fortunately, this was relieved moments later by the little quick pitter-patter of feet on the dirt floor. We all glanced down simultaneously, as if on cue, and saw a small chipmunk come to a dead stop right in the middle of the three of us. It must have suddenly realized what these three giants were and scurried off in an instant back under the bench.
That's the head librarian,
Stingo quipped. Glenda let out a smiling sigh of relief. Stingo continued to pull out a variety of things, among them a few magazines, a pistol, more badges and medals, his old uniform and cap, and a flag. Stingo had a war story that went with nearly each object. Stingo piled up some of these old things on the bench for us to inspect even as he spoke. He then took out a conductor's baton, giving it to me.
You like that?
He asked, handing me the stick. It was just about the last thing I would have expected among a collection of war memorabilia. I looked at him from the top of my eyes as I examined it and saw he was watching my reaction.
You should know what that is, Stingo said.
Where'd you get this? I asked.
Found it in the basement of a little French chateau dodging bullets one night. It was with some other things. And a book.
Must have belonged to a conductor. Stingo pointed his finger in the air and waved it around. Oh, yeah, it's beautiful, I remarked as I pretended to conduct some music, as I had with other musical batons in a conductor class at music school. I then handed the baton back to him, and he held it with one hand, and it was as if he was using it to direct his recollections. It was as if he was conducting a symphony of memories that went back far beyond my birth and my world of experience. Some of his battle stories were too horrendous for me to ever want to repeat in detail to anyone else. War is an ugly affair, and that was the impression Stingo wanted Glinda and I to thoroughly get. I imagined what it might be like to actually be stuck in the middle of an armed conflict where these things were not just souvenirs, but necessities to survive. I shuddered. As he explained things, Stingo marched through World War II as an infantry scout for General Patton. He experienced the horrors of war from the front lines. Like my own dad, he had monstrous shells whizzing over his head back in 1945, thinking he might die any second. We listened to Stingo talk as images flashed through my mind's eye, as bright as if they were being projected there in a darkened movie theater. Stingo held up the baton again, almost as an afterthought, while he continued the narration. I began to drift off somewhere else. I flashed back to an old telegram that my father wrote to his brother during the war. I could see it clearly. I had kept it for years on my dresser, never really thinking about what it really meant until I had some of those dusty, real bits of war in my hands up on the mountain. France, February 1st, 1945. Private First Class Jean Abercrombie, 357th Infantry. Dear Milt, don't know why I haven't written you since landing in France, except that I thought the letters home would suffice. Now, I find that won't do because I must have someone really know how I feel, and of course, that can't be Mom and Dad. By the way, I'm not in the hospital because I've been hit. Damn near wore my left ankle off, lugging 42 pounds of mortar up and down the mountains of Luxembourg in Belgium before becoming bad enough to be sent back. In other words, I couldn't walk. Brother dear, be damn glad your ulcers are looking after you. Combat is no place for man or beast, and consequently, we turn into a combination that isn't very pretty. Back here, think back over the comparatively few days I've been up front. I'm even more frightened over what I've been through than what I was then. And believe me, I was pretty shaken up then. Up front, there isn't much time to think. Unfortunately, we have plenty here. Incoming artillery is bad, but the worst is to have tanks firing at you, whether they're coming close or not. The projectiles are so damn fast, I wince thinking of them. My love, with kisses to Ida and the baby. God bless the Russians. Love, Jean. I saw my father's pen in his hand as he wrote the letter. It transformed into a key, and that key had opened a door from his time and place. His handwriting had created the outlines of a hallway that stretched from his world into mine, onto the mountain, up the steps of the library cabin. I had walked down that hall, transported into his distant world for a moment. Stingo cleared his throat and brought my attention back. I was safely among the rustling leaves and the sweet and peaceful atmosphere of the mountain. The most dangerous thing I would be dodging would be a falling pine needle.
Off again, I see. Are you back? Stingo asked.
Oh, yeah, sure. I shook my head as I came out of my reverie. Please, go on, I said, blinking my eyes. Stingo smiled at the corners of his mouth, paused for a few seconds, put the baton back in the box neatly, then went on.
When I got back from the war, I asked myself this one haunting question. Why must I kill my brother? Nobody knew the answer to that one, he continued. Finally, after 10 years and going to 3 universities trying to find the answer, I asked my professor of neurology at the University of Chicago that question. He told me, "You're not going to find the answer to that one here in Academy. If you want to solve that riddle, the answer will be in here," as he pointed to his own gray skull. My professor said, "The answer to why men kill each other in war will be found here, inside the human brain. You can stay here at the university and go slow, or you can go fast and do the research on your own." "I wanted to go fast," Stingu said. "So I dropped out of school and started this place. That was 30 years ago." He looked out the cracked window pane above the bench into the darkness of the forest outside. Glinda took her finger and wiped off some of the dust on the bench top, nodding her head. 30 years since you cleaned, too." A long, awkward silence. I looked at Glinda. Glinda looked at me, biting her lip. Then she looked at Stingo, who looked at us both under his bushy eyebrows. Then we all broke out laughing.
You've been listening to Secret of the Dormant Brain Lab, Niles Abercrombie and the Book of Wands, Volume 1 by Neil Slade, read by the author. For more information, visit www.bookofwands.com and also the main brain site at www.brainradar.com. This audio recording, copyright 2019, by Neil Slade Books. All rights reserved.